world system. Definition. A world system is any historical social system of interdependent parts that form a bounded social structure and operate according to distinct rules, or a unit with a single division of labor and multiple cultural systems. Three concrete instances stand out: mini-systems, world empires, and world economies. The modern world system is a world economy. It is larger than any juridically defined political unit, and the basic linkage between its parts is economic. It is a capitalist world economy because the accumulation of private capital through exploitation and production and sale for profit in a market is its driving force. It is a system that operates on the primacy of the endless accumulation of capital via the eventual commodification of everything. In the 1970s, historical sociologist Emanuel Wallerstein developed one of the most well-known versions of the world systems theory. In hopes of understanding the historical changes associated with the rise of the modern world between 1450 and 1670, Wallerstein devised a concept which would allow for a comprehensive understanding of the internal and external manifestations of the modernization process and for analytically sound comparisons between different parts of the world. Between 1150 and 1300 AD, after almost two centuries of economic expansion and prosperity, the feudalistic Western Europe saw a severe economic downturn from 1300 until 1450. Wallerstein argues that Europe moved towards the establishment of a capitalist world economy in order to ensure continued economic growth. In response to the feudal crisis, by the late 15th and early 16th centuries, the world economic system emerged. The capitalist world system refers to the international division of labor, which divides the world into core countries, periphery countries, and the semi-periphery countries. Each region has different characteristics, which Wallerstein believes to be key in analyzing each region's relative position within the world economy. The core countries had strong, developed governments, extensive bureaucracies, and large armies. They were the most economically diversified, wealthy, and had the greatest power over non-core countries. This region also tended to have the strongest working class. The periphery countries lacked strong central governments and generally exported raw materials to the core. They were the least economically diversified and had a large peasant class, with a high percentage of poor and uneducated people who were often exploited laborers. The semi-periphery countries were the midpoints between the core and the periphery regions. These areas were comprised of either core regions in decline or peripheries trying to improve their position in the world economic system. The semi-periphery regions weren't as wealthy as those in the core regions, particularly because they did not manufacture high-cost goods and prevail in international trade. Like peripheries, semi-peripheries were often exploited by the core. However, they also exploited their own periphery subordinates. Before the Columbian Exchange, there were no oranges in Florida, no bananas in Ecuador, no paprika in Hungary, no tomatoes in Italy, no potatoes in Germany, no coffee in Colombia, no pineapples in Hawaii, no rubber trees in Africa, no cattle in Texas, no donkeys in Mexico, no chili peppers in Thailand or India, and no chocolate in Switzerland. The Columbian Exchange route was pioneered by Christopher Columbus in 1492 when, in search of a new route to India, he discovered the New World, America. Discovering a world rich in exotic foods and supplies, the Europeans quickly took advantage of this new shipping route. The Columbian Exchange was a widespread exchange of plants, animals, culture, diseases, and ideas across the globe after Christopher Columbus's voyage. This widespread exchange changed the ways of life around the globe. Suddenly, countries were exposed to products and ideas that they had never dreamed of before, much less consumed. One striking example is the Irish and the potatoes. Before 1492, there were no potatoes anywhere outside of South America. But by the 1840s, the Irish were so dependent on potatoes for their diet that a bad crop was the cause of the terrible Irish potato famine. But this exchange across the ocean was not one-sided. The first import that the Americas received, the horse, would drastically alter the lifestyle of their inhabitants. Suddenly, the Native Americans of the Great Plains are able to sustain a nomadic lifestyle, hunting bison from the backs of their horses. Further south in the Americas, African coffee and Asian sugarcane became the main crops of the new Latin America plantations. However, not everything that was exchanged was beneficial to the receivers. Some of the things most commonly transported overseas were disease. Among the hardest hit by these new diseases were the Native Americans in the New World. Their immune systems had never before encountered the diseases the Europeans brought and had no way to fight any number of them. Diseases from the bubonic plague to the common cold ran rampant throughout the indigenous populations of these countries.
Overall, the Columbian Exchange helped to progress the expansion of Europe as well as the development of the new Western world. Long-distance trade with the Americas and the East provided enormous profits for a small merchant elite in Europe. This helped to solidify Wallerstein's theory and the emergence and progression of a modern world.